Hey guys, good afternoon. Welcome to the Art Talk series by Sneha Arts. As you all know, Sneha Arts is one of the leading art galleries in South India. And Dr. Snehalata Prasad is the director and art collector. And she does a lot of art events with the brand name of Sneha Arts. And today we have eminent artist, Mr. Subodh, who is joining us today. And about Mr. Subodh, he is from Goa. And he's a painter, sculptor, and installation artist. Today is the first time I came to know about what installation art is. After seeing a couple of collections and, you know, Googling and researching about it, I got to know a few details about it. He's also, you know, a person who's quit his doctorate or a doctor profession and came into art. And he currently runs a private art gallery museum in Goa. And he's pretty well known for his artwork and installations. So he's done a lot of exhibitions and installations, not only in India, but across different countries, and pretty known for his work. There are a couple of series of artwork which he's done, which we will play in a couple of minutes. So thanks a lot, Subodhji, for joining us. Maybe you can, you know, talk about how this particular journey from being a doctor and, you know, how did you choose to become an artist? And especially your installations are just superb. I got a chance to collect these memories for displaying to our friends here. So maybe you can, you know, talk about how this journey started.
Well, let me first start with the comment which you just made, that you had no idea what installation art is about. True. Now, this is a very interesting and important thing, because in a country of 1.3 billion people, I don't think more than 1 lakh people in the whole country connect with contemporary art, because most people have no idea what contemporary art is about, and only about a lakh of people in the whole country. And that is none of their fault. It's not your fault that you didn't know about installation art. You never get an opportunity to look at installation art. And if I tell you about 10 names of important artists in India, I think very, very small percentage of people must have heard of them. For example, Subodh Gupta, Sudarshan Shetty, Riyaz Komu, Krishnamachari Bose, Vishwanathan, Francis Newton Souza, Vasudev Gaitonde, Pushpamala, Anita Dubey, Shilpa Gupta. These names are names of some of the most important artists, but general population, most of them have no idea who they are. And that's because they have never had an opportunity to look at the contemporary works of art. And just to make one more point about the names which I just mentioned, I must tell you that two of these artists, Francis Newton Souza and Vasudev Gaitonde, are originally from Goa. They are Goan, of Goan origin. And Vasudev Gaitonde has a record of selling a work of art for the highest price in Indian market, Indian art market, and that's 29 crores, a painting which is just about this size. And Francis Newton Souza, about 27, 28 crores. So even financially, it's a huge thing, but most people have no idea. So that is the reason, actually, I started the Museum of Goa, of which I will speak later. But now, the first thing to begin with is my own journey from a medical doctor to an artist. See, I was a very good student. When I was 18 years old, I was 7th in the board. So I could get admission anywhere. And my father was a school teacher. And we came from a rather poor family. And I liked almost everything. And there's hardly anything which I didn't want to become. And since I was in the top 10 in the board, I could get admission anywhere. So it was my choice. But then, except for becoming a priest, a soldier, a mafia don, I could sort of become anybody else. I didn't want to become this, and I couldn't become a musician because I couldn't sing well. So these four professions were out for me. Three because I never wanted to be a soldier, priest, and a mafia don. But and perhaps I didn't want to be a shopkeeper, sitting in a shop and selling things. But everything else I loved. I wanted to be a doctor, I wanted to be an engineer, an architect, a writer, a scientist, even the chief minister. That was also on my cards. So then I became a doctor. And I started practicing. I started a hospital in Kalangut, which is supposed to be the queen of the beaches in Goa. And the first hospital in Kalangut was started by me way back in 1982. I ran it for about 7-8 years. And well, I enjoyed it. There was hardly anything I didn't enjoy, but I enjoyed it. But I suddenly realized that this was too much of a routine. So the idea of spending my sort of life just treating cough, cold, typhoid and malaria was not very challenging for me. And on the top of it, suddenly there was a big boom in the tourism. The charter flights, which you had mentioned earlier, started coming in. And then we had a lot of British tourists. And the only disease they were suffering from was loose motions. And so almost 60-70% of my patients were British. And again, I didn't want to spend my lifetime treating British loose motions. So I thought India has taken enough shit from the British. I didn't want to take any more. So I gave up my medicine and I started doing art. And I can tell you, for the last 30 years, I only do art. I make my living only from art. And I'm a very, very happy person. You can see that. And I basically believe that if you do something which you love to do, there is a possibility that you'll be happy. And if you do something which you don't like to do, you'll be definitely unhappy. So the advice for the young people especially is to please do what you love to do. And this is not the advice I give to other people's children. I also do that to my children. And my son is also becoming an artist. Wow. Well, okay. So then for the last 30 years, I've been doing art. So now you can put the next question.
Yeah. So being an artist is a different role. You know, you're doing things for yourself and, you know, it's like at your own wish, at your own timings. Jab mood aaye tab, you know, art bana. But, you know, maintaining a gallery is basically, you're also, you know, taking up the responsibility of showcasing others' art in your gallery and, you know, getting the best value for their art. So how did you transform yourself to this particular role?
No, well, I have always been an activist, even from my college days. I have even been to the jail for defying the chief minister of that time. So I have been an activist. And so for me, I always wanted to do something which is something for the society. And it is not just for the artist, in general for the society. So as I mentioned earlier, the Indian population does not get opportunity to look at contemporary art. So I started a Museum of Goa. And this Museum of Goa is 5 years old and it had become sustainable. We used to get 300 people every day paying a fee of 150 rupees every day. And 90% of the people who visited my museum had never ever been to any museum in their life. So they were tourists coming into Goa. They would see the signage of the museum, Museum of Goa. They would think that this is the Museum of Goa, which it is. And then they will come. And so it was very satisfying. And plus showcasing works of other artists, because it is very important that if you're an artist, you also have to appreciate other people's work. If you're a singer, you have to also listen to other singers. The same way, I believe that it's important that I showcase other people's work, and it has been working. So I have been, for the last 30 years, as I told you, making a living and a fairly good living out of art. And I have traveled the world, shown my work all over. So my responsibility of supporting other artists is very important to me. And in India, we have very few galleries as such. Now, I'm very glad that Dr. Snehalatha is having a gallery. But then we have, you know, most galleries across the country are in five-star situations. And the general feeling among the common people is that art is for them, the richy rich, it's not for us. Most common people are even scared to go and press the bell of the gallery.
Yeah, I agree. I'm one of them. So.
And so for me, I wanted to democratize art. So the Museum of Goa gets everybody, from farmers to the rich business people. So we get all kind of people, from Vijay Mallya to a farmer. And I must tell you a small anecdote, which I was very, very proud of. One day, we had about 10-15 farmers who came to the museum. And from their dress, you could make out that they are simple people, because they were wearing simple clothes and they looked rustic. And I asked them, where have you come from? They said, we have come from just across the border in Maharashtra, about an hour's drive from Goa. And we have come from there and we have come to look at your museum. And we spoke in Marathi. And I said, how come you came to the museum? Who told you to come to the museum? They said, another farmer, our friend, had been to Goa. He saw your board and went to see the museum. He liked it so much, he came and told us, please go to Goa. Don't look at the beach. Don't go to the beach. Because their beach and our beach is the same. Because this is just across the border. They said, the Samandar unka aur hamara ek hi hai. So Samandar mein mat jao. Museum of Goa mein jao. So this is the biggest receipt of sort of acceptance which I have got because that was the purpose of my museum, to connect art with everybody. And I must also add, okay, you can put your next question, but the role of art is not to decorate somebody's walls and halls. That is not the role of art. It is much, much bigger. Yeah.
Good one, sir. So you're doing amazing installations. So when did you decide that I should also, I mean, apart from the contemporary art, or maybe it is part of the contemporary art. So when did you start doing installations and, you know, your best work?
Yeah, well, initially, like all artists, my father was an artist and he used to paint realistic work. And he taught me the basic drawing, making a landscape and making a portrait. That's what I learned as a little boy from my father. And then my father did not like or did not connect with contemporary art, in the sense with the modern stuff. He could not understand it, so he claimed, and he would say it's all nonsense, then don't go there. So he used to like only the realistic work, and most people in general, for them, art is essentially a landscape, a portrait, maybe a picture of Buddha, a picture of a flower pot, or a picture of a lady wearing a wet sari and carrying a pot. This is a general idea in most people's heads, what is art about. But art is much more beyond that. Art can be created with anything. And initially, when I had an opportunity to go to Europe, when I was still doing my watercolors, landscapes and portraits, and then I started visiting contemporary art spaces in Europe. I went to the Tate Modern, I went to in Germany to Pinakothek Moderna, so all the modern contemporary art museums. And I must tell you, I did not understand, I understood very little. So I could not connect with these works. So I had two choices, either to accept my father's verdict that modern art is nonsense, or check it out for myself. So I decided I will check it out for myself. And then I realized that it was a wonderful thing and a great Pandora's box was open to me. And what I am doing today is something which my father could not understand or did not like, but he is not alive now. But if he was alive today, he would have loved it, because I make it so simple that everybody connects with it. So installations, I started on the beach with sand and light, and that was most accidental. Would you like to show some of the image before I speak?
Yeah.
Because then people connect with it.
Yeah. So friends, since we're talking about installations, so let's go through a collection of art and installations done by Subodh sir. So it's a 1 minute video, so enjoy this. So right now this is the sand and light. These are installations called shells. These are installations for fishermen and the ocean. These are installations on unfolding of a dream. And this is the installation called Of the Donkeys, Demons and Diabolic Death. Okay, these are works on oyster books. So we will talk about oyster works after this particular display. This is the installation called Chilies. Yes, sir. We're way back.
Say that this is too short a time that they had an opportunity to look at my works, because my works are definitely better looking than myself. And I think I would request the audience to check my website, subodhkerkar.com. And I have a regular Instagram account, which is again subodhkerkar, where I keep posting very interesting things. Even you can see me drawing live on my Instagram. And I have a YouTube channel, which is also called Subodh Kerkar. So the audience is requested to check that out, because with just such a short 1 minute video, they would hardly be able to see much work. But let me start with the first work, which they saw, with sand and light. Now, this was almost an accidental installation. You know, I had created a disc in copper. And when any artist is a beginner, you usually do works for the hotel lobbies. Decorate them. Mm-hmm. That's the kind of work you get. And I had also got some work in one of the five-star hotels to do the lobby. And so it was a big copper disc. And I don't know what came over me. I just put that disc in my jeep and headed to the beach. And the disc had electrical bulbs underneath it. And I dug a crater in the sand with the help of a laborer, with the help of a mason, and put the disc on the top of it, top of the crater. You must have seen that work. And then I ran the electrical cables under the sand and took the electrical connection from a shack. And when I put the lights on at about 6:30 in the evening, I couldn't believe my own eyes. I had created something which was not intended. It was like creating a new planet. And it was a very ethereal feeling. It was I felt that I am God, because it was like a creation of a new planet. And I called the installation 10th Planet. So that was an accidental installation with sand and light. And after that, I created many installations using sand, light, shells. Well, there won't be time to speak about all of them, but we can move to the next series of work.
Yeah. So how does the oyster works start? Because these are
the oyster works is the latest work of mine. You know, I have been working on the ocean for the last 30 years. In the sense, I call myself an ocean artist. That's because I have done work on the sand. Mm-hmm. I have done work with shells. I have done work with old boats. Initially when I started my artistic career, I used to like to paint seascapes, and I would paint the boats. So I have done hundreds of works connected with the ocean and the life of the fishermen, including portraits of the fishermen initially. Then I thought, since I have done so much of work with the ocean, and I feel that I am an ocean artist, because the ocean is both inside and outside my work. The ocean is my inspiration and my theme. The ocean is my medium. And so I thought, let me sign a memorandum of understanding with the ocean. So I signed an MOU with the ocean. I created some objects and I kept them at the bottom of the ocean in a cage. And I kept them there for 1, 2, 3 years. And this was where the river meets the ocean. And when I brought them out after a long period, the oyster shells had formed on that. So all the works which I showed you, there are oyster shells on the sculptures. There are plates from China, which are maybe about 100 years old or more. And I buy them in antique shops and then put them in a cage and lower the cage at the bottom of the ocean for maybe 2 years. And so the ocean works on it. And so this is a work in collaboration with the ocean. And I don't know how much to charge for these works, because they have remained in the ocean for 2 years or 3 years. And I do not know how much the ocean charges per hour. Yeah, so these are works in collaboration with the ocean.
How do you know what where exactly you dropped that particular
That's
cage?
Pretty simple. I mean, so you have a cage and you bring the rope out and tie it somewhere. It's
Okay.
not exactly open ocean. It's where the river meets the ocean. So I know the location.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's superb. I mean,
yeah.
but you cannot really have anything on the plate. But you know, I'm sure these are very valuable because you these are already antique, and you know you got them recreated, reinvented them with ocean involved in it.
Yes. Yeah.
Superb. Superb idea. So where do you get these creative ideas from?
Well, it is like this. I've been sort of only thinking art. For me, I mean, I work or I have fun every day. There is nothing called a holiday for me, because I have no, there's no difference between a holiday and a working day in my life, because it's all the time thinking about art and creating art. So if I sort of travel, I do the same thing in a different place. So I will do maybe some drawing. So I will come with some ideas and I will do an installation. So for me, I enjoy everything I do and look forward to create new works. There is a major difference between a computer and a human brain. When you put the computer off, shut it off, it doesn't work anymore. But then when I sleep, the brain still works and new ideas come up. I get dreams of works which I'm going to do. Even last night, I got a very interesting dream, and this is about a sculpture I might be creating for the airport in Bangalore. So I had these ideas, and I jot down the ideas because there's a little notebook next to my pillow. And it's not a disturbed sleep, it's a sort of a creative sleep. And I write down those ideas, and these are the dreams which sort of I dream about sculptures or installations, works of art I'm going to produce. I have never seen those in my life, but they are the ones which will come up. So in that sense, the dreams are my sketchbooks. It's a wonderful sketchbook to have a dream. And so all these ideas come to you basically because you are marinated into it. You are sort of pickled in art.
Yeah. So all the installations are unique. they have their own message, and you know they're all positive. But the donkeys and, of the donkeys, demons and diabolical death, I think, you know, any story behind that? Because wo thoda hatke tha.
Story behind that, I don't know how much the audience was able to look at those works, but those works basically begin with some even paintings. There was a green painting and a red painting. Now, I have a, this is in response to the terror attacks on Mumbai, which happened after the demolition of the Babri Masjid, which was a very unfortunate event, in my opinion, because I'm a very political artist. And I think an artist has to be political, because, I mean, art is not about if there's a war happening outside, you can't be sitting in your room and painting flowers.
Right.
So that's not it. So art is a whisper of time, whisper of the era. And so you have to respond to what is happening around you. Only then art becomes authentic. So I started thinking about terrorism. I started thinking about the present times. And I realized that if I have to describe the present world in two words, the words are terrorism and telecommunication. Because never in the history of the world, terrorism was so organized. So much of terrorism all over the world. And I mean, at the same time, we also live in times when the telecommunication is, at the height. Almost everybody has a mobile phone. The mobile phones which we carry are superior to all the computer system which was there in Apollo 11. So this is much more advanced. So now look at these things. We live in a time with such advancement in communication, telecommunication, and we live in times which is full of terrorism. Now, I believe that the terrorism is a product of non-communication. When religions don't speak to each other, when countries don't speak to each other, when groups don't speak to each other, when communities don't speak, when ideas don't speak to each other, terrorism comes. Otherwise, all problems which we have could be easily solved across a table. We don't need bullets to solve problems. So terrorism is a product of non-communication, and this is the paradox of our time, because in spite of such advances in telecommunication, we don't speak, we do not communicate, because we speak a lot, वी स्पीक अबाउट हाँ अभी कहाँ पहुंचे हो, बस में बैठे हैं, हमारे पड़ोस वाला है ग्रीन शर्ट डाला है, चाय का पानी रखा क्या, शक्कर डाली क्या, हम आ रहे हैं अभी 15 मिनट 20 मिनट में. सो बोले तो बोले, कहा क्या. सो द वर्ल्ड इज टॉक, देयर इज समथिंग व्हिच आई कुड डिस्क्राइब एज अ संवाद रति. सो मच ऑफ टॉकिंग बट वी एक्चुअली डोंट से एनीथिंग एंड दैट इज द रीजन व्हाई टेररिज्म हैज एडवांस्ड. सो दिस आइडिया ऑफ आई मीन द पैराडॉक्स बिटवीन टेलीकम्युनिकेशन एंड टेररिज्म वाज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू मी. एंड देन द टेरर अटैक्स हैपेंड इन मुंबई. I believe that all these terrorists, there were many people, why did you hang, I mean, Kassab should have been hanged immediately and all this. But I have a son who is 18 years old and now he's 22. But now tell me, 18, 20 years old cannot be a bad person. So all these terrorists, 10 terrorists who came and shot and got killed, were people who were robots. Forces were higher up had brainwashed them. And so I believe that a terrorist is a donkey, a robot with a donkey's head. So I made 10 masks of donkeys and we had a performance with actors, which was called a dance of death. And this is basically the idea that a terrorist is essentially a sort of a donkey, a robot with a donkey's head, a programmed child. And so this is a kind of a protest. This is a trying to say that, okay, these terrorists are just they're puppets. Because a donkey can be programmed to take things from place A to place B and stand there. The same way, this terrorists were programmed. So this work is basically my take on terrorism.
So much of, you know, depth and the meaning in, you know, this particular, you know, one bit of art.
Yeah.
So why are Chilis so close to you? Why Chili installation?
Well, I mean, one of the reasons why, I mean, we have a lot of problems in the world is also where people don't read and they're not aware of the history. We live in times where there are certain politicians talk about India's pure culture. They say, no, we have to go back to Ghar Wapsi and all these kind of things. And they're talking about India's pure culture. Now, I must tell you that the food which our great, great, great grandmother cooked is much more foreign than Sonia Gandhi. I will try to make a point. Now, chilies have arrived in India from Brazil, and Goa was a gateway. Chilies arrived somewhere in 1530s. Before that, India did not have chilies. We only ate pepper. And what is pepper called? Kali mirch. The chilies arrived from Brazil via the Portuguese, and Goa was the gateway. People tasted them and they found it very similar to Kali mirch. So what did they call them? They called them Lal mirch and Hari mirch. So chilies are an imported thing, and there is no other object perhaps which has come from one country to the other, one continent to the other continent, and has become such a part of that continent. Like, can you imagine our food without chilies?
No.
We cannot. So if you are talking about sort of Ghar Wapasi and all this nonsense, first you have to give up chilies. And then you talk, because chilies are not from here. Eh? So this is why my sculpture of chilies has even a political message. That our food, and it's not just chilies. We have hundreds of food items which have come here from all over and have become part of us. Our culture, India's culture, is good, rich, because it's plural. Let me tell you, there were two important events in the history of India which sort of changed the food of India. One was the entry of Vasco da Gama. This was on 20th of May, 1498, and the other one in 1526 of Babur. Babur comes with pulao from Samarkand, and the pulao gets married with Indian spices and biryani is born. So what we call the Indian cuisine is essentially a mixture of Mughal cuisine and Indian cuisine, which was there earlier, and the Portuguese, they brought the ingredients. So this is all a mixture, and this has happened now in the 16th century. Yeah, so all my works have many layers of meaning, and art is basically about communicating things. Art is not a decoration, and this people need to understand, and that can only happen when there is more education.
So true. But I really admire your knowledge, you know, the history you got into every art.
Yeah, basically that's important, because when many people feel that art is about a skill, if you can draw Amitabh Bachchan like Amitabh Bachchan, you are an artist. No, you are not an artist. You are just copying the face of Amitabh Bachchan. So art is not an activity of skill. Skill is needed. It is like if you know grammar well, that doesn't make you a writer. You will still be just knowing grammar. So drawing is like a grammar. Art is an activity of intellect. Art is an activity of thinking. When a thought comes on canvas, it becomes a painting. A thought becomes a sculpture. A thought becomes an installation. And in music, a thought becomes sound. And in literature, thoughts become words. So art is essentially, all arts are thoughts in action. Thoughts converted into different mediums.
I love this comparison, what you said. You know, just because you know grammar doesn't make you a good writer.
So, well, I think we almost finished 40 minutes.
Yeah, 30 minutes. So we still have a lot of time. So
how do you ask whatever you want to.
Yeah. How do you manage installations? So sorry, I'm so stuck with installations because, you know, I'm so impressed and, you know, this is new. So I'm excited. So how do you manage installations when you go abroad? Yahan pe, you know, you have people, you have masons who help you out. There are artists who come and do some of these installations. Bahar, how do you manage?
No, well, let me tell you an anecdote. I think, did you show the pictures with shells?
Yes.
Oyster shells?
Yes.
Now, when I gave up my medical practice and started painting watercolors on the roadside, my patients thought, kya achha itna practice tha, kya kar raha hai? Doctor saab kya kar rahe hai? Then, after some years, they saw me planting shells on the beach. Now, when you see a doctor, an ex-doctor, planting shells on the beach, the only thing they thought that abhi pura kaam ka gaya hai, is a mad fellow, should be admitted in the hospital, mental hospital. Because idea that an adult is sort of spending his time planting shells on the beach is nobody can sort of feel that he can make a living out of doing that. So I started planting shells. And initially I did it because it looks very interesting. And slowly I started thinking and many kind of layers of meanings were added to it. And when I plant shells, what do I create? I create the impression of the ocean. The oyster shells which I plant, the mussel shells which I plant in Goa, they're green on one side and they're silvery white on the inside.
Right.
And I plant them in such compositions that it mimics the ocean. So I create ocean using mussel shells. Now, my museum, Museum of Goa, in Goa, is a museum which I claim is a museum of history. History narrated using a contemporary idiom. And actually, I have been talking to your government in Hyderabad, perhaps in future, to create a museum of history of Hyderabad. Yeah. So hopefully it happens. Well, it was just people came to Goa, looked at my museum and said, why can't we do it in Hyderabad? So maybe it will happen. I don't know. But anyway, so I study history and history becomes a footnote to all my works. And so the mussel shells, for example, when I plant mussel shells to create ocean, how is this installation connected with history? You're planting shells. Where is history? Now the history is this installation celebrates the ocean. And ocean has a huge role to play in writing histories. Because if we consider the sculpture, if we consider Goa's culture as a sculpture, who is the sculptor? The sculptor is the ocean. The ocean has brought so many things and taken so many things. A lot of food items came, religions came, a lot of cultures came here. People came and integrated here. The same way a lot of people from here went away and through the ocean took them away. So ocean is a very complex thing. The oceans of the world have separated continents when the continental shift happened geographically. But it is also true that the oceans of the world united the continents because it was through ocean that people came from one shore to the other. So the ocean is a medium of intercontinental cultural dialogues. Ocean provides a space for dialogues of civilization across continents. And that's the role of the ocean. And I celebrate the ocean, creating the ocean using mussel shells.
Wow.
Yeah, that's what I do. And what was your question? How do I handle this when I go abroad? Now here, when I want to plant mussel shells, it's easy because I have a lot of help. Now I was invited to do this in Denmark.
Mm-hmm.
So I went to Denmark. I sent about 100 kilos of green mussel shells from Goa to Denmark. And I arrived in Denmark, and the organizers took me to a big warehouse, and there were heaps of mussel shells which they had procured for me. And mussel shells in Denmark are black. They're slightly bluish black. So they said, these are your mussel shells, please create the installation. And I said, we need to wash it because they were all full of mud. So they sort of, okay, what do you want? So I wanted big buckets and a hose pipe and the gloves. So they all organized that. And they said, now clean them. I just started putting some water and put my hand to start cleaning them. And my hand froze. It was -4 degrees. Now, there's no possibility that I could clean these mussel shells because the -4 degrees, and I'm not used to it, first of all. And then luckily, I had a friend in Denmark who was into construction business. And he said, don't worry, Subodh. So he came with his van, which had a kind of a motorized pressure pump to have a jet of water. So he came with this jet pump, pressure pump, and just sprayed the mussel shells and cleaned them for me. And then I had to create the installation by planting thousands of mussel shells, again, in temperatures of 0 degrees and -1 degrees and rain on the top of it. And so we just made an announcement in the social media. And we had about 15 people who came with raincoats and umbrellas to help me create the installation. I can tell you one thing, art has a huge power to break all barriers. I think art should be used to basically stop wars between India and Pakistan and all countries. Because I think art has the power to connect. Art is a universal language of mankind. Have you ever seen somebody like a Bhimsen Joshi running with a dagger behind Bismillah Khan or somebody like that? So art basically takes you beyond that. And art sort of connects. So it's very important to promote art, not only, I mean, it's not, again, I told you, for the decoration, but to sort of make people more plural. I think I will quote a Rumi poem. Rumi says there is a field of the right and there is a field of the wrong. And beyond that field, there is another field. There is a field of the right and there is a field of the wrong. And beyond that, there is another field. Let us meet there. So art catches your hand and takes you to that field, which is beyond the field of the right and the wrong, and where basically there's a plural dialogue. So that is the role of art, one of the roles of the art.
So I heard you're very spiritual and very close to nature also. So can you throw some light on when did this happen?
Earlier I was an atheist, but now I'm very much a believer of God. But I must tell you that believing in God does not need religion. It does not need religion. Today, I have not shown that work, but I have created a work called Spiritual, in which Spiritual, S-P-I, is in plain white, and the ritual is studded with gold. All religions of the world have become basically a bundle of rituals, and the spiritual is disappearing from the religions. It also sometimes becomes business. So I will tell you what is spiritual for me. When I sit here, or you are sitting there, we are actually not just stationary. We are part of the cosmos, the whole universe. The universe has billions of galaxies, and we belong to the Milky Way galaxy. And this galaxy of ours, the Milky Way, is traveling at about 26 million kilometers per hour. So we are all traveling in this galaxy at this speed. Then the solar system is moving around the center of the Milky Way galaxy at a speed of about 80,000 kilometers per hour. So we are moving there. Then part of the solar system, the Earth moves around the Sun, and the Earth rotates around itself. So we are moving. Now the idea that we are residents of a tiny speck in the whole universe. And to realize that we are tiny specks on that tiny speck called Earth is to be spiritual. But we are insignificant, but we are also not insignificant. We are significant because we are the part of the whole thing. We are part of the universe. And when you realize that you are a part of this whole, there is no place here for hatred and hate and for anger and for jealousy and for, all these kind of things people fight about. So there's only place for love and empathy. And when we realize that, you are spiritual and you are a believer in God. So to be a believer in God, you don't have to go to any place of worship. You just have to connect with the whole cosmos and feel a part of the cosmos. And then you feel a part of the humanity. Gandhi is my teacher in my spiritual pursuit. And Gandhi believed that there is a sort of everybody's soul is connected. And I believe that if I hurt you, it is not just that you will be hurt, I will be also hurt because our souls are connected. It's a universal kind of a consciousness, which is no more a sort of a spiritual idea. It's a hardcore scientific idea. And I believe that to be spiritual, to be religious, is to basically believe in truth and empathy and compassion.
Well said. I really like that. Aapka thought process is different hai, but you know, bahut, matlab, yeah, once somebody, you know, listens to it, I'm sure they will, you know, not think of getting angry or, you know, getting into hatred. They'll at least think twice before getting into it, and they'll remember what you said.
Yes. Before. No, I never get angry and I never hate nobody. That's the only thing I've learned from Gandhi. I mean, it is very difficult to practice Gandhi because he's a very complex character. So he had an epic life. But one thing I definitely sort of learned from him and I'm practicing is not to hate nobody.
So the last question. You know, what are your point of views for contemporary art in India?
On contemporary art in India. So contemporary art in India, as I said, is only appreciated by about 1 lakh people in a country of 1.3 billion. So it is very important that more and more museums, like the museum which I have set up, are set up everywhere. And this is not a sort of a problem of not having money. If one artist could set up a museum, I mean, the government, or there are many people, but I think art education is very important. And that's what I have sort of devoted myself for today. I mean, I agreed on this program to talk to you free of charge, basically, because I want to get this idea across that art, this is what is art about. And this is needs to be propagated. And art education is of most very, very important. And I have a YouTube channel through which I do that. Right now, I'm doing it in only in English. But I have plans that, okay, I will sort of have all these talks of mine which are connected with art and ideas translated in most languages of the country. So that you cannot bring about a change in anything in this country in English language. It has to be in local languages.
True. I completely agree. So if somebody has to connect with you with respect to your gallery.
Yeah.
So if there is an artist who wants to place their art, all that. Yeah. So what is the process? What are the prerequisites?
We welcome artists, but we have a curatorial team. Mm-hmm. So anything which comes in the gallery, in the Museum of Goa, is sort of goes through a curatorial kind of a test. And but at the same time, I know that there's so many very, very good artists all over the country, including I know quite a few in Hyderabad. And Hyderabad has a wonderful college. Lakshma Gowd was teaching there, and most of my artist friends who are very, very good artists here are products of Hyderabad. That's most of them students of Lakshma Gowd. And so Hyderabad has an art school, but again, in spite of having one of the best art schools, common people are not connected with contemporary art. So there are more activities needed to connect, and there are more activities, more talks needed in local languages. We should be talking in Telugu. We should be discussing in Telugu. I don't know the language, but that's what I mean, that in the local language, these ideas which I spoke to you about, this also needs to be communicated to people who don't know English, because only about 10%, even less than 10% of Indians know English.
True. So any message for the budding? I'm done with the questions, but any message before we end the show?
So the message for the budding is very artists? Simple. The message is sort of art is not an activity, as I said, of sort of you want to sort of, earn this much money, you become doctor, you want to become this much money, you become a dentist. It's not like that. Art is a passion. And if you want to become a good artist, there's only one way. You have to be sincere to yourself. And that is true with everything else, because to be happy is the purpose of life. And there's no other purpose of life. And Gandhi puts it again very beautifully. He says you can be happy only if what you think, what you speak, and what you do are in harmony, in perfect symbiosis, in perfect harmony. So what you think, what you say, and what you do. And if there is no harmony in this, you can never be happy. You might be able to fool everybody, but at the end of the day, when you put your head on your pillow, you know what kind of a person you are and what you have done. So to be sort of having a perfect sort of symbiosis of your thought, your words, and your action is the sort of purpose of life, which will make you happy.
Good, sir. Yeah. Just checking if there are any questions from the audience. Okay, I think there are no further questions from the audience, but thanks a lot for taking time out and, you know, joining this particular show. Wonderful experience. I learned a lot about not only about the installations, but also the story behind each installation, the history behind each installation, and your thought process behind it. Initially, I thought they're just chilies, but now I can, you know, every time I see chilies, I'm sure I'll relate with you and, you know, how the journeys of chili started in India. So awesome connection. I thank Sneha ji for giving this opportunity for me to connect with artists like you, where I'm also, you know, doing some homework and, you know, getting connected to not only you as a person, but your thought process and, you know, how this journey started, what you think of each and every aspects of life. So thanks a lot, audience, for connecting. So we will share the social media angle and the website of sir, and there are a lot of artworks have gone through his profile pictures, have gone through his works, and you know, the what we shared is just a small summary of it, but do go through all his works. He's, you know, put it across there. And yes sir, agar you know, definitely go aayenge to definitely want to see, meet you and visit your museum,
because yes, okay.
So thanks a lot, and have a great day. Thank you, friends, for watching this talk show by Sneha Arts, and do keep us keep connecting with us frequently. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you. Bye.
Okay. Thank you.